Thank you, Nelson. Okay, I expect you to give me like the warning sign if I'm talking too much, right? Yeah, thank you. So first, a kind disclaimer from a non-technical guy to the 15 years of Type 3 and internet agencies, I have become more and more of somebody that is flying on the meta level and really sucks on ground level. So I hope that you see the stuff that is written on there on the presentation, and that will help you to understand it. So yeah, okay. So why is Forget IT on this presentation, not DKD? Just as a small introduction of Forget IT. Forget IT is a EU-funded project that DKD started or was invited to join 1.5 years ago. And the idea of Forget IT is to create computational services or systems that are able to tell you what kind of content, data, information can be deleted, can be forgotten, or which, or positively said, which information or which content can be kept because it has a value for the company that you're working for, and for the others that will be coming after that, that you quit the company and you might join another company and so on and so forth. During that research, we came up, DKD was asked, hey, you're expert in the field of Type 3 CMS because you have been so innovative with Apache Solar, and would you like to join us? And then we said, yes, what is it? And basically, that's was a good occasion for us to dig into the CMIS standard that somehow came to me a long time ago. I remember Karlsruhe giving a presentation together with one of my colleagues on Java content, GCR 170, 268. So this is really the evolution of that talk, and I want to give you a small introduction to CMIS, so and how it works. Okay, so what does CMIS stand for? Basically, it's an abbreviation. So I have to put it a little bit that I can have also a look on that. So it's an open standard that has been developed by the OASIS group. That's an a standards platform or standards committee platform. You can look up that on the internet, and they somehow wanted to tackle, or they somehow create standards as also the document standard for Word, or for Word documents, or you call it for the open office documents, in example, have been worked on and created there. So basically, the CMIS stands for an interoperability system or service that helps you to bring content, as Xavier said, from one system to the other. The rationale of that is that in the content management systems that we observed in the last years, content was some kind of stuck to a database, no? Or there's a database level, there's some kind of a abstraction level on top of it. And if you look at the companies that you have been might have been working with in the last years, many of those companies have a big effort in bringing content that is stored in one silo, in one content management system, to the other parts of the other companies, and basically then they're using another system, and then that's nice for us as integrators that we start then to work on all those kind of interchange formats. But the moment the content management system that was on that side starts to change, you redo the whole thing again. So somebody long time ago somehow said, oh, this is something that we need to take care of, and basically that's the the idea of CMIS. So it comes with an abstraction layer on certain, because abstraction is fine, and this abstraction layer is kind of standardized and offers some types and some immutable stuff, but also stuff that can be permuted by you while using it. So I will show you some of the basic ideas. So what are the benefits of CMIS? So basically, it's easy said that it's easy to learn and to adapt. That's what technical guys are saying. As a manager, I find it often difficult to explain, but if I tell the people that, think of a press release that you have in one system that you want to send to another system, and then that's where actually CMIS makes a lot of sense. If you have kind of structured content somehow that is kind of structured by the model or the some kind of the use case that you have. It's supported by a widest range of vendors. Some of them are non-open source, like SharePoint. We heard some rants today about that, but funnily, SharePoint has adopted to that standard. So in the newest SharePoint versions that are out, they're even using CMIS 1.1, which is quite a good thing. For you integrators looking into that. There's also Magnolia, that is an open source CMS system that is heavily working on CMIS. We have Alfresco, which is a dual base, dual license content management and media repository system. I don't know who of you have been working with it, but I think it's a great platform. And there's Adobe with their Day products and their the Adobe Manager products that are using content CMIS as some parts of their way or how they store objects. Many of the ideas there, or Adobe bought this company, and many of the people that have contributed to the Apache CMIS implementation called Chemistry are from the Day working group there. So there seems to be some kind of a interesting coincidence there. So, and also there's Nuxio, also a dual license content repository. So one of the benefits is that basically through the CMIS, you can allow end users to access content in its raw format, right? So there's no backend that you need to have. It's just a plain interface. There are different interfaces I'm going to show you later, and so you have possibilities that people can just write a small client to access certain endpoints in that system. So and. As I said, many of those things can be done by using those clients, or those specialized applications can be done by using some of the standard libraries that are existing there, and it as I said, it also offers a standard API that whereas you can access it, right? One example for, let's say, some example architecture. I don't know, I don't think you were going to see that in any kind of a company, but we have on the lower side of the presentation of this picture, we have the CMIS repositories that are offering their services into a system architecture, and they can be accessed through HTTP, an example, and you have all kind of clients that could be content management systems, could be some specialized applications, could be even your iPhone that could be accessing those interfaces, as we saw that as an Objective-C implementation for the CMIS library. What are CMIS use cases? I was explaining the whole time that there's a application to repository use case, which is I guess, the most common one, but there's the other repository-to-repository implementation that is possible. So you can imagine content distribution for a company that has diverse locations, and you might want to have local copies of the repository, and then you might want to send this stuff back to the main repository while still giving the people the possibility to access the content very fast through the network and so on. So this is a great use case. So how does the typical multiple repository example look like? Basically, in the middle, we have something called the ESB, the Enterprise Service Bus. Who of you is already using some kind of Enterprise Service Bus, like Messaging Queue or Apache Camel or something? All right, so you guys know that this is actually the service bus stuff is what you often find in companies and large organizations that are seeking for enterprise content management. So basically, there lies a lot of integration possibilities for you there. Okay, basically, the application could be Typo3, could be whatever is creating content. Okay, so some explanation of the domain model that is there. I was telling that there are some kind of principal objects that exist. Don't ask me what ACI means, but basically with this you shape some kind of the, you can reshape those principles. Then you have an access control layer that is there. At the end, this creates the objects. The object has primary properties and secondary properties. You see this, the gray objects here are things that come or have come up with the 1.1 with 1.1 implementation of CMIS. Otherwise, the non-grayish thing are objects or are things that are in the CMIS 1.0 standard. So the object itself can be a folder, can be a document. So basically, you have two kind of top-level documents. The document can contain other objects. Basically, it's all everything is organized in a kind of a tree, like we know it in Typo3. So we have a page tree. So there's some kind of a page representation in there. It's possible to have relations between those objects, which is a strong thing, I guess. It's like the one-to-n relations, so you can have one object that is kind of a category, and then you can reuse that. Technically speaking, the objects can be identified by a global UID, so there's no ID that goes up by one, like in Typo3. So I guess this is one of the things we would never do it again if we would rewrite it. So I guess also NEOS did that they didn't concentrate on IDs that are going up by one, so they also did the UID effort. So basically, the CMIS also does not only hold objects that are text or stuff like that, but you can also like have special binary objects that can be put in a binary field. So think of images or PDFs that you might want also to store as a document there. So I spoke a little bit about the services in the CMIS standard. There's a lot of them, and they all concentrate on doing one thing right. So this is the we have basically as a base the repository service, which is doing is telling, oh, I'm a repository and I have these capacities. So that's it's possible for the client to adapt to what the repository is actually able to do. So that is also great great thing. If you're implementing, you don't need you just query that repository service and ask that the repository, okay, what are you actually able to do? So you do not really run into that you do not fire up later queries on things that might come back with an error message or this kind of stuff. So there's navigational services that help you find the information within the repository. So this is think of it like a phone book where you can, or like an index where you can look up for special things that is in the metadata, or you can say, okay, where is this UID? Where can I get it? So there are object services. Basically, they're used to do the work on the actual objects, like creating, reading them, updating, and deleting them. So this is all nice encapsulated in there. There's multi-filling services possible where you can like say, okay, I have this object and I want to put it in that folder, but I need to take care that this object is also put somewhere else. So if you want to do some revisioning and some kind of distributing, think also of the multi-repository setup. So with this, you can really take care of distributing content. Yes, discovery services. I don't think that I really need to name all of them. Some of them might be, the green. Yeah, you want them to be named? Okay, green card. I can skip it. You can read. All right. So next time, note to myself: make it smaller. So, but one thing that I really like is the versioning services. So it's built in, right? So I can send in a new version of my objects and the repository takes care of creating a new version of it. So where is that in Typo3 CMS? It's in the application, on an application level, but we were young and we didn't know how to do it. So at that time, so luckily, okay. The bindings are a little bit for those that are interested into talking into the with the repository. Nobody does SOAP calls anymore, but seems that there's a large legacy, a large base of legacy installations that still do SOAP XML calls into some kind of other places. But so this is some kind of the base for that. So this. I will show a little bit later of the other bindings, but basically the SOAP bindings give you access to the whole implementation. There's different kind of authentications that can be used to access this. This is really special enterprise stuff. So you have like web services security or username token profile. This is if you're in the enterprise, this will ring a bell. It doesn't ring a bell to me, so I just take it for granted. The CMS repository then is able to do message transmission optimization mechanism. That's super, huh? That's a super keyword. Don't ask me about that, so sorry. this second binding is the Atom Pub binding that I guess at that time when CMIS was invented was kind of the way to exchange content from one system to the other. I guess most of the popular blogging platforms have this, like WordPress. They have some kind of a Atom Pub RSS based interface. It follows some kind of a REST paradigm and has a HTTP method, uses the HTTP method to do the CRUD operations. In this, the recommended authentication is to do basic authentication using SSL. So different advantages here. It does not really cover the whole specification. An example, it does not support the create document from source function. This is what my developer, told me. This is, you need to tell that to the people. And it needs two HTTP calls to access the content. So basically, and the get document displays the entrance to the content, which is sometimes under certain circumstances you don't want to expose this to the outside world. So you might want only to handle this through the UID, and you don't want to expose the whole pass because of some security reasons or to other access reasons. One thing that we think it's outstanding here is the browser binding protocol, which is based on the JSON object notation, JavaScript object notation, and this is what we actually also are going to use or are using for our implementation. So how we also an example, Alfresco is what is Alfresco is offering. Has some advantages as it covers the whole specification, which is good, and it gives me different ways to authenticate to the repository. The benefits here, they seem more compact and performant, and they are also suitable for mobile applications and browser apps. So. And you don't need additional client libraries for that. Basically, yes, almost every platform supports JSON link data. That. So why do we need CMIS 1.1? Okay, so this is really like a technical thing. So for me, it's possible to change the type of an object, which was not possible in 1.0. The secondary objects that have come can be added dynamically to the object. So that means, just think of it, how you store right now data in Type 3. That's, you need somehow to, you're not able to, while using the object, to change it. Yeah. So when is this an example? Something that you would really like to do, think of migration, think of content object migration. So with Type 3, you need somehow to create and to use maybe other forms like going to Doctrine and do a Doctrine migration there, just to do the change sets on the database. So so this is something that I guess it's technically quite appealing for you guys that are working with highly changing objects through the time. Now, I don't know how many of you have been working on long-term projects, you know, where the customers are very, very conservative on changing and on touching content. So this is the way on how you can, in example, in a second repository, start to manipulate the content there and then just switch to the other repository and then just do the same thing there and test and so on and so forth. So this is something that we do not really see somewhere. I guess that Type 3's NEOS holds some of those ideas, but if somebody can tell me on that, that would be excellent. Yeah, so 1.2 brings the browser binding that we're using and also the property, the bulk property POPs possibilities that where we can do lots of changes and transaction just by giving one call. And we don't need to have this logic somewhere in our application. So we can just say, all right, these are the objects that please do that with them. And we don't need to go through an array of objects that we have to hold in our application just to do that. Main features, main new features of 1.1 is a new item object type, which exposes other object types via CMIS. So this is once again something that then if you're a technical guy, non-technical guy, me doesn't ring a bell to me, but this is obviously something I need to tell you. It's possible now also to append in the constant stream, large files, and large files mean bigger than 2 gigabytes, into the repository. So you can really, like in example, take care and say, I have this set of backups that I want to hold as part of my repository, and I want to be able to put them in there. But it could be also large images or versions from your Photoshop files and that kind of stuff. Okay, typo 3 in CMIS. Now it's getting interesting. Yeah, when we started, we identified that we needed the whole forget IT idea is about storing this information in some kind of a backend system. So how do you store your website? Yeah, nowadays I don't think that anybody of us is just doing beside backups any kind of active storing of the objects that we have in Typo3. So you might go and say, oh, I go to this one section of the admin and I then do an export of my TCA data. I do it in an XML, you know, you know what I mean. It's this possibility. You can query a table and just create some kind of very simple XML and just take this and use this XML as some part of a storage of that data. Yeah, but there's no way at the moment to really go and say, I want to have this press release. I want to have it somewhere stored so that I can retrieve it in 10 years from now. Yeah. So what we were trying to do in the forget IT is then really to take care of that. Is that you're able to have an independent storage or independent preservation of your Typo3 content. So then we looked for standards. When we found then the CMIS standard that was able to do so, and then we started to have a look what is there, what is in the TER, in the tremendous extension repository, and we found some, but we found them, they're not maintained or updated since years. Wonder why? Because nobody's using it. So nobody knows about the standard. The only people that are using the standard have done so for one project. So there's no, basically there was no sustainable idea behind it, just to use it. And it was using, and they were using an existing CMIS library for that was created in the Apache Chemistry project. And this library is technically speaking quite old. So and somehow there has been a move or a changement in the way how the PHP world is starting to live up now with upcoming coding standards and all the kind of things. So there's some kind of great news that I'm going to tell you on that. So and those extensions were done before CMIS 1.1, so there's no in implementation for that. And the PHP license, the PHP library from the Apache Chemistry is not object-oriented. So we are all one step further, I guess, here. One thing that we're working on at the moment is to really to transform this Typo3 object into CMIS. And in practice, it means that we want to convert first of all TCA into and file objects into CMIS objects. Why that? This comes a little bit from our background. As you might know, we have been creating the Apache Solr search for Typo3, and there we have one component that is allows you to index very easily TCA tables into Solr objects, and you can query those objects and make them part of your pages and make them part of the of your search experience that you want to have in on your website, and this very fast. So this is some kind of the same approach as that we said. We start with the TCA first because we think this is easier and also for the project faster to reach. And when we were working on the project, we had to somehow lay down actual use cases. And so what did we do? So we did a survey last year, you might remember, and we asked you about the websites that you are creating with Typo3. And one result of the survey was that almost every website was using TT News or News as repository for product information, for company information, use information, and so on and so forth. So most, I don't have the number, but it was way over 80% that everybody was using TT News. Maybe because it's built into Typo3 introduction package or something like that. But many people have this product press release use case. So we thought, okay, let's do it this way, because collecting pages, collecting groups of pages is way more difficult than just taking care of some TCA tables. So this is a little bit of a laziness, and also to achieve some kind of visible goals, right? So what are we doing right now is what is the TCA? I guess you all know it. It's like kind of a way to describe all the different kind of data types that you might want to collect or want to put into one collection. And so we have the TCA also gives the Typo3 backend the way on how to present this in the backend, right? Or so basically this is some kind of a representing layer, right? So this is how I understand it. And if you want to interact and to work with it with objects in your DOM, what we have done, we are using one extension that is existing at the moment. It's called Identity. I don't know if you heard of it. It's an extension that was created by a very smart guy, Thomas Maroshik. And this extension adds UID support for Typo3. So you have for every object in Typo3, for every object that has a TCA and has an additional global ID identifier. And those global IDs are can be used to really to identify all objects. Think of multiple Typo3 installations where you can, with that, you can create some kind of interchange of that without wondering, oh, now in this page I had page ID 1, and now I need to wonder in this installation I had the other page ID, and so on and so forth. So basically, this gives you some kind of a good way to access objects through different installations. Okay, so objects in Neos. So please correct me. I have no clue. I remember having some kind of interesting discussions with Robert Christian Müller, also with some guy that from the Symfony PHP CR corner. I know that there's a lot of movement going on in also in Typo3 Neos. So please correct me if I'm saying bullshit here. So I understand that the storage that we have in Neos is inspired by the GCR implementation, or is some kind of the deviation of the PHP CR. It's not, it's inspired, right? It's not that they took the PHP CR implementation that came way later than the Typo3 CR implementation, but basically it seems that there's some kind of, I look in your garden, you look in my garden, but we don't tell that we're neighbors, something like that. So it's my feeling, right? So the Typo3 content repository offers some funky and real good features that we don't see anywhere else. So that seems that this is also the reason why we want to stick to Typo3 CR, which is a great idea, but we need to take care that we don't fall into the not invented here sickness, right? So this is a little bit of a thing that we need to take care. That's why I'm here to tell you, hey, there's a standard that might be some kind of an idea where we can, in example, also have all those funky features just by extending the standard, just by using the stuff that is within the standard. So just an offer, right? So it's not that I want to impose anything on you, but at the moment, PHP, CR, and JCR nodes can be translated very easily to CMIS. This is what people are going to do. And so I think we really need to take care to to have this also in mind with our Type 3 CR objects. So our expectations are quite high that PHP CR to CMIS is easier to do so than, in example, the TCA file to CMIS border that we're doing, the way that we're doing a Type 3 CMS. So this is an expectation that we see. One of our co-workers in this project is an excellent independent Danish developer called Klaus Due. I assure some know him by his battle name, the Nameless Coder, and he's working exactly on the CMIS foundations for Type 3 CMS. But we hope that most of that things that are done there can be reused or can be used as a source of inspiration, as everything will be turned out into open source from us. So what are the benefits for web CMS? Just to recap, we think that it's great to decouple the content from the actual system taking care of delivering the content to whichever platform, whichever system you're targeting at. Since we think that specialized applications are going to do the one job right instead of doing five jobs halfway right, so making people feel uncomfortable with it. We think it's future-proof, as it's a standard that is 5 minutes. Okay, I'm almost done. So I hope also that we can reduce redundancies, so that we have one part where the content is, and we don't need to have another content representation somewhere else, and so on and so forth. And expanding the possibilities. So what is the roadmap? So as I already mentioned, we are working on a real PHP CMIS library that will be able that is following the Java implementation very consensusly, and it will be threaded. That means performant and object-oriented scalable library. I have one of my brightest people working on it, Sascha Egerer. Some of you might know him as one of the Type 3 active contributors at DKD. And he started working on that. We have some, and we want to support CMIS 1.1. Regarding CMIS, there's an upcoming committee that has been formed by the OASIS on CMIS for them. So it seems that there's some kind of moving also going on in how to address special digital asset management problems that exist in the world, not only content management, but also asset management things with that standard. So this is something that is happening by the end of the month, and I hope to be able to send somebody from the Type 3 community as an observer into this technical committee. So if any one of you is interested into doing that kind of work, I'm more than happy to help you on that. So we hope to have a first version beginning of next year. So we're working at the moment on it, but we have some impedients and we have some other stuff that we need to do in this Forget IT project. Every year you need to finish some kind of a final work, and it's often that projects' goals are often different than technical goals. So there's a little bit of that into this. We hoped certainly to have more features, been able to implement more features, as we hope to get and create some kind of acceptance on CMIS. This is on my Christmas wish list for 2015 or 2016, that maybe we get some kind of a CMIS native implementation in Type 3 CMS, maybe also in NEOS, so that we have some kind of a possibility to dream of a, you know, kind of a bridge between those systems as a possible way on how to migrate from one system to the other. This is really management top level 10,000 meters. Oh, I forgot, I have no fuel. So this is just the thing. I mean, it's just an idea. Just think of that, that's a possible thing. Where to get more information? This is the very last slide. There's an excellent book on CMIS and Apache Chemistry, which is the implementation of CMIS, the very first that was made to the Apache Software Foundation. There's the CMIS spec site. There's a chemistry, I will push that on SlideShare very soon, so you don't need to type that. Well, there's also the alternative Terra plugins that you can find out. Okay, this is it. Thank you very much. I hope I didn't bore you too much. Any non-technical questions?
Do you have any questions?